So as you know, for low degrees of myopia and hyperopia, we usually perform corneal refractive surgeries. But for higher degrees of myopia, more than 8 or 9 diopters of myopia and more than 4 or 5 of hyperopia, we need to go inside the eye. Either removing the crystalline lens, and then we have some problems of presbyopia, and in high myopes, retinal detachment risk, or phakic IOLs, such as Artiflex, Artisan, and ICL. And also in some cases of not so high myopia, such as this case of -5 diopters of myopia, if the cornea doesn't allow, due to thickness limitations or to a flat corneal curvature, as you can see, this patient has a central corneal curvature of 40 diopters. So if you go for a corneal surgery, it's going to be too flat, and the corneal optical performance will not be as good as we want. So in some cases of low and moderate myopias, we also need an intraocular surgery. Another good point of phakic IOLs is that we can adjust surgery. Zaldivar from Argentina named this bioptic surgery. So I always offer my patients double surgery. First, to correct the high amount of ametropia of refractive error with an Artiflex or Artisan. And then, if necessary, 3 months later, we can go and redo a surgery in a cornea. So that's a nice thing about this procedure. We can fine-tune the result of this high myopia or high hyperopic patients. And it's very, very easy to do. This is a video from the 90s where we used at that time the ACS. So you can see I'm doing a LASIK flap with ACS over Artisan patient. And this patient had also RK incisions with hyperopic Artisan, and I was doing an ACS flap over it. So it's not dangerous, it's very safe to perform LASIK surgery after Artisan or Artiflex, regardless the microkeratome or if it's a femtosecond laser, etc. So this is a very nice thing that we can adjust the result of Artisan or Artiflex implantation. Another possibility, of course, is ICL. The newer models are a little bit better, but they are still close to the crystalline lens, and that's the problem. I don't like this, because sooner or later these patients will develop cataract. If you can take a look at the literature, up to 1/3 of ICL patients will get cataract. So my preferences are either Artisan or Artiflex. These are well-known lenses from the 70s, when Dr. Wurst invented it for aphakia first, and then there were some modifications to correct phakic patients, to correct myopia in 91, and then hyperopia in 92, and then they included astigmatism correction in 99, and then the foldable model, Artiflex for myopia, in 2003. And the United States approved it. It got approved by FDA in 2004 for Artisan IOL. And here in Europe, Artiflex was approved in 2005. I had the chance of participate in a multi-center study in Brazil since 1999. So we've been implanting Artisan and after Artiflex lenses since then in Brazil. As you all know, Artiflex has the advantage of being foldable. So we can implant it through a small incision, 3.2, with low induction of astigmatism. And it has lots of advantages. It's far from the anterior chamber angle, in the opposite of the angle-supported phakic lenses. It's far from the corneal endothelium, if you have enough anterior chamber, of course. It's far from the crystalline lens, in the opposite of the ICL. You don't need to measure white-to-white, so one size fits all. That's a very neat thing of this lens. And it's, of course, it's reversible. You can remove it from a 3.2 or 3.5 incision. Its optic is of silicone, polysiloxane, and the haptics of PMMA. It has an overall diameter of 8.5 and the optic diameter of 6.0. The Artiflex is made to correct up to minus 14.5 diopters of myopia, and you can include a toric correction up to minus 5. Sometimes we need to use the rigid lens, Artisan, and it has it comes in two versions, 5 or 6 millimeters of optical zone. So you need a larger incision, and then of course you're going to induce some amount of astigmatism. That's why I prefer for this lens a scleral tunnel. And the other advantages are the same as Artiflex. It's a one-piece IOL of PMMA, and it corrects from plus 12 of hyperopia up to minus 23.5 of myopia. And you can have a toric Artisan as well, correcting up to 7.5 diopters of cylinder. And here is an example. It's placed far away from the angle, far away from the endothelium, and far away from the crystalline lens. So it's a very nice place to correct refractive error. Of course, you need at least 3.0 or 3.2 millimeters of central anterior depth from epithelium, and a regular and normal endothelial cell count. Nothing abnormal with this. And the preoccupation of endothelial cell loss is, of course, reasonable. But with this lens, there are plenty of studies showing that the endothelial cell loss with the years are not much higher than the normal endothelial cell loss. So it's a very safe intraocular lens. It's a very safe procedure if you are a good surgeon. Of course, you have a traumatic surgery, you're going to lose endothelial cell loss. But from the lens, it's a very safe procedure. If you compare with another fake IOL that was on the market until some years ago, Cachet from Alcon, you can see Alcon said that you needed a patient with 3,700 endothelial cells to implant in a 25-year-old patient. And for Artisan or Artiflex, you need 2,800. So they've got many decompensated corneas, so they removed from the market. So Artisan and Artiflex are very safe. We can do in both ways. My preferred technique is first to implant the Artisan and Artiflex and wait 3 months to have a stable refraction, and then perform corneal surgery if necessary. Of course, you can do the flap at the same time of Artisan or Artiflex implantation. You can lift the flap, put it back, and then implant the IOL, and wait 3 months, and then lift the flap and perform the excimer laser ablation. So here is the technique. My preferred technique for the rigid ones, the Artisan, is to perform a scleral tunnel of 5 or 6 millimeters in length, depending on the lens I'm using. This one is a 6.0 millimeter Artisan, and the technique is pretty straightforward. You need to protect corneal endothelium with a nice OVD. I prefer a cohesive viscoelastic because it's going to be easier to be removed at the end of the surgery. If it's not a toric IOL, you can fixate, you can enclavate wherever you want, but I prefer at the 3 and 9 o'clock positions. And then you grasp it with this special forceps. That helps a lot. And either with a bent needle like this or a vacuum fix, it's an instrument from Ophtec, you can enclavate. And don't be afraid to enclavate enough iris tissue. That's a problem when we begin the surgery, our learning curve. We don't grasp too much iris, and then we have some dislocations. It's mandatory a peripheral iridotomy or iridectomy with a YAG or surgically at the time of the surgery to prevent pupillary block. And then the surgery is complete. Of course, for this 5 or 6 millimeters tunnel, we need to suture. And then the surgery is complete. You have to remove OVD through the two paracenteses, of course, and that's it. For the Artiflex IOL, the insertion is a little bit different. The Artiflex is mounted in this specific spatula, and it goes inside the eye through a 3.2 millimeter incision, and it folds on itself in the incision. So you hold the eye and gently you insert it. And here I do a near clear tunnel. I don't go in a scleral way. I prefer clear corneal incision. And then the same maneuvers. You turn the IOL to the horizontal position. And for this IOL, we use a specific forceps to grasp the haptics, as you can see here, and not the optic. And it's much easier with this instrument than with the other one. So I perform nowadays all my artisans and artiflex with these forceps. It's very, very easy to fixate and to enclavate iris using these forceps. So of course you have to center the IOL under OVD, peripheral iridectomy, and even being a 3.2 corneal tunnel, I prefer to suture because it's an anterior chamber IOL. I don't want a shallow anterior chamber in the first post-operative day. So my experience with these lenses is with 200 level eyes, 158 artisan and 53 artiflex. You can see the range of refractive errors I corrected. In myopia, the average of minus 12, ranging from minus 6 to minus 24. And the post-operative is pretty good. Of course, in the beginning, the calculation was not so precise, so we had some residual refractive errors, but nowadays it's too rare to have this, but these are all my patients. And hyperopia, we could correct from plus 6 to plus 16, and also the results are pretty good in average. And of course, we can adjust surgery. As I told you, I prefer to adjust with LASIK or sometimes PRK. The good point of these lenses is that we can implant them even if the cornea has a previous surgery. LASIK, PRK, or RK. This is a case with a high hyperopia after RK. So it's pretty safe to implant in these cases. Even being a high hyperopic eye, this eye was previously myopic, so it has a very nice and depth and deep and anterior chamber to implant the IOL. We can implant in a PK or lamellar graft eye, it's very safe. Or if the eye has a ring, intrastromal ring, we can also use this lens. As far as results, of course, in any intraocular correction of high refractive errors, we have gain of lines. Almost 20% of patients gain line compared to the glasses or contact lenses. And of course, we have some loss of lineness, mainly due to cataract. Iritis is rare, is about 5%. It's more frequent with the Artiflex, like it's reported in the literature. And in artisan, it's 3.3%. Cataract around 5%. But these are patients that have up to 16 years of artisan implantation. And you know that high myopics, they have more cataract than the non-myopic eyes. And earlier on, endothelial loss has an average 4.7. It's pretty good low loss. IOL displacement, some cases in the learning curve when we are afraid to grasp a lot of iris or from trauma. Glaucoma is rare, mainly due to steroid use, and retinal detachment, nothing to do with the artisan or artiflex, it has something to do with the high myope. This is an example of anterior uveitis, or iritis, as I told you. It was more frequent with the artiflex than with the artisan. This paper 3 years ago showed also an incidence of iritis higher in the artiflex group than in artisan, maybe due to silicone, we don't know. And there are some other reports showing this. There is a one report showing that this might be a TESS, toxic anterior segment syndrome, so we don't know. So we need to use more steroid in some cases, but most of them resolve with clinical treatment. IOL dislocation, as I told you, It was a low incidence, mainly due to a poor iris enclavation or to trauma. It's very easy to reposition this IOL. It's a very safe surgery. This is a very nice way to grasp iris. The amount of iris grasped, enclavated is fine, so you should always enclavate a lot of tissue. Don't be afraid to do this. And cataract is a possibility. These patients will have cataract in the long run, nothing to do with the lens, but with the age and with the high myopia. There are some papers saying that they develop 4 times more cataract than the non-myopic eye. So we don't know if the artisan accelerate this, but it's located far away from the crystalline lens. So I don't think it's due to the artisan. But it's pretty easy to remove it and to perform the phaco and IOL implantation. Of course, if you have an artisan lens like this, you have to enlarge your incision to get it out. And then you have to close the incision to perform phaco. If it's an Artiflex, it's going to be removed through a 3.2 or 3.5 incision. So if it's artisan, you need to suture to close the incision to perform phaco. Sometimes like this, it keeps leaking from the incision, so you need to suture a little bit more. But that's not a problem to perform cataract surgery in an eye with a previous Artiflex or artisan IOL. So in conclusion, I'm very happy with this IOL, and I've been using for 16 years, and that's my first choice for correcting high myopes and high hyperopes. Thank you very much for your attention.